Java to work on Android phones and writing an app in Swift to work on Apple phones. Now we can build mobile web apps that work on both. The reason I think it's powerful for students is it's much easier to get started than having to learn a complex language like Java. And it lets kids build things that work on their devices, no matter what kind of device they have, and to share with their friends and their family, no matter what kind of device they have. There's some things in the slides that you might want to click on rather than reading off the screen and typing. So if you want to open up another tab in your browser and open up your own copy of the slides, you can even make your own copy and take some notes in it if you want. And you can always access these slides later if you want. I've been teaching this stuff for a few years now. I've taught a year-long high school class. I teach a semester-long university class. I did a three-hour version at the 6E Education Conference back in March. I haven't tried to squeeze it into 90 or 75 minutes yet. So the purpose of this session isn't for you to gain expertise in either the web languages or in building apps in the web languages. You're going to leave with a sample that you can let your kids hack up to make their own apps that they can use. And you're going to learn a little bit about what's possible out there in the world of web apps now. So the first part, I'm going to talk about building apps in general. And then we'll move on to doing some specific hands-on stuff to actually build the apps and play around with some code. And you certainly have the right to vote with your feet. And please, interrupt me at any point with questions. If you don't want to interrupt me at that moment, please make a note of it, and we'll come back to it later. So, the goals, understand the building blocks for making an application, understand what kinds of things we can do with the web languages now. Yes.
Is that link on the document from the previous slide?
No. I'll bring it back up.
Sorry.
It will be. We just created it about 10 minutes ago. So. Got it?
Thank you.
All right. So the agenda, here's the agenda. I'll let you look at it for a minute. See how far we get. As happens in other sessions, we might go a different direction depending on the desires of the room. Some of this is going to be pretty high level. Some of it might get down into some technical weeds. If something's flying by you, that's okay. That's expertise isn't the goal of this. All right. So just what is an app?
Program that does something on the app, and I'd say, I normally say that the app, it tends to be self-contained, so it's standalone essentially on any specific operating system, short for application. They time to time update, improve, make an improvement. It can be survey, tool for survey to monitor the user, what's necessary or what's not enough, what
to use the programs to design, like a friend's game of what you would want.
I hate to decide chairs, thank you.
Not so much the actual.
All right. right, so let me just hear a couple things, a couple ideas. Just give me one thing that you talked about. What's an app?
It's a program.
A program, okay. This is a no right answer kind of activity. Yeah.
There's a certain level of interactivity.
Okay, interactive. This is one way to think about an app development process. And some of these things that we all came up with, right? First, we have to have an idea. What is it, right? There's intention about building something that is usable and saves people time. So we just need to come up with an idea. Then we need to describe it in human terms, right? Hey, I want to create an app that lets me search for restaurants based on zip code and displays them as a list on the screen. That's a human level description of the app I want to create. Then, right, if we think about it as a building exercise, right, I need to think about the raw materials I need to build that. So I need to know how to put user interface elements on the screen. I need to know how to find that data about restaurants. So, or if you use the recipe metaphor, right? We need to assemble all the ingredients for whatever we're making. And then we need to plan how that's going to work. So what events are going to trigger actions in my app, right? Okay, well, I'm going to type in my zip code and then click a button, and when that happens, it's going to go get the data for the restaurants. Right. How are we going to deal with that data when it comes back, right? Then we get into turning it into some specific code, right? We've gone through all this thinking, all this problem solving that's hopefully done in a creative context with a lot of collaboration and communication among students, right? Then we have this last piece, coding it and delivering it. And some of what you're getting today is my messaging to people about why this is important stuff. So let me leave that slide up for a minute. We can take a look at that. And of course, the levels at which you do this may be different if you're dealing with high schoolers or if you're dealing with fourth graders. How much you expect them to do on their own versus how much you bring in other people to do. So it's a rich process. Creating that code is the last step of that process. It's a heresy to some people. But I would argue it's the least important part of the process in terms of an educational experience for our kids. It's a necessary part of the process, right? But that last step continues to change, right? The Swift language didn't exist 3 years ago, right? And some new language is going to come up in another 3 years that is going to serve that last step of the process. So my argument is we don't want to get bogged down in the details and specifics of that last step, right? That shouldn't be where our focus is, because that's going to change. And all that other work is really important. Yeah?
I just want to say that's a really interesting point, because that's actually the most thing that I'm worried about. As an educator, like I have prior knowledge, but that prior knowledge is C and C++.
Right.
And then when going into, like, say, an intro to apps course, or CS course, like, I'm worried about the syntax.
Okay.
And so I think it's, I agree. I'm not saying I disagree with you.
Yeah.
I don't disagree, but for me as an educator, that's the one thing I'm most worried about, quite honestly.
Okay. And that, I think, is another reason why making web apps is an easier path. More students have some knowledge of it. There's a great amount of resources out there and tutorials. I think it's an easier path, right? Anybody tried to put public static void main in front of kids and just have their eyes closed? You know, even if you tell them, just ignore that and we'll explain what it means, you know, 6 months from now. There's a lot of overhead in learning one of those more complex languages. So, hopefully by the end of this, you may believe me that the web apps are the way to go.
No, I'm not saying I disagree.
Okay.
I just think it's an interesting perspective. I never thought of it like that. Actually being more concerned about the front loading than the actual coding report part of it.
I always used to say, you know, whether you ask your boy for lunch in French or you ask them in German, wondering with you, I worked in the business world as you did, and the most important thing is to get the user requirements correct.
Yeah.
After you get designed the whole program, you give it to a coder who can do that last step.
Right.
And if you give them the wrong design, then the user says, this isn't what I wanted, your backend score is zero.
Right, and let me come back to that. You bring up a good point. I still get questions that surprise me from parents, like, aren't those jobs all outsourced, right? Aren't all those jobs going to India and China? This last one can, if all of this has been done, right? If you've gone through all this and spec'd out something in detail, yeah, you can outsource that last step, but you can't outsource all this other stuff. This is the stuff that's most important, right? And this can't be outsourced. And this is the stuff, yes, this has to be done, but this is the stuff that really makes you valuable as a developer to be able to think through and solve problems. All right. So again, here's what I think are some of the benefits of web apps, both for professional developers as well as for students. The web language is JavaScript, which is the language that runs in the browser, is an increasingly valued language. It's used in a variety of contexts now. There's a server-side implementation. JavaScript is used in a lot of Internet of Things devices, so it's a valued language. It's not like, we're going to play around with this because it's easier. It's valued. All right. I need to give you a little bit of information about how the web works to make what we're doing a little easier. And just a lot of people enjoy learning some of these. This is basically what happens, how the web works. Right? You type in an address into your browser. You're the client. Your browser is the web client. You type in an address. The browser makes an HTTP request out there in the world for a file at some location, some server, uic.edu or cvs.edu. And the server that hosts that sends an HTTP response back to your browser that has the content you asked for and some response code, like success or failure, file not found, something like that. But understanding that this exists, this request response, is useful. And we've got some really cool stuff in the browser now that lets us look at this stuff in detail. So, these green clock slides are kind of, hey, interactive time. So what I'd like you to do is demonstrate. The browsers have something called developer tools. And you can get to those in a couple of ways. In Chrome, in the menus, it's more tools, developer tools. Perhaps the easiest way is if you're on a site,
like
this one. If you just right-click and select Inspect, it's going to open up a tab with the developer tools. And then we're going to do a little bit of playing with that for just a moment. So go ahead and do that. Open up the developer tools. And please help those around you.
Your site or another site?
It doesn't matter. Just so you can see the stuff that's behind the browser.
The easiest way is to right-click and select Inspect from the menu. But you can also, there's keyboard shortcuts, Control-Alt-J, or it's there on the menus also. And
if you're logged into your CBS email account in Chrome, then Developer Tools is disabled as a policy. So you need to open up a not that window.
Look on the browser.
CBS. Yeah, I know. CBS Google accounts have developed a little bit.
I use it in my class all the time.
Tracking items. There's there's an interesting graphic here showing you how long it's taking for different things to be downloaded and rendered by the browser. If you scroll all the way to the top, we see that the first thing that comes in is an HTML file, right? And those of you who've done some work with HTML, it's just a text file with links and tags and things. The browser receives that file, goes through it, says, oh, are there other things I need? Then generates requests and responses for those. And those might be images, those might be style sheets, those might be scripts, could be video, could be audio. Again, the takeaway I want you to have for a moment is just that some websites involve a lot of requests and responses, and we've got tools that let us examine exactly what's happening on our web page. These developer tools, they're called developer tools because they're really useful for us when we're developing for the web. When I was working in the field, these dev tools didn't exist yet, and it was really hard. The only way you could find out what was happening with your code was to put little alert box pop-ups or other things. So, 300, now mine's up to 367, because you've been on pages where you're there for a while and a new ad comes up, right? So, there are additional requests and responses going on while you're on the same page as new ads pop up in front of you. All right. There are other tabs here. Elements shows us all the objects that were created. But we're going to come back to that in a little bit. I just want to make a point about this. So, this is what happens, right? When you get a page, right? The browser makes a request, it handles the responses, it reads the HTML file and creates the user interface based on the specifications in the browser about what different tags should do on the browser. And it can execute JavaScript commands. So if there's script in the page, to do something when you click a button or when you click an image and it expands larger, that's scripting on the page, and the browser can execute JavaScript. That's the language. There's a lot more, but we'll say that for later. So the browser is an application that can do these things. It makes requests, it handles responses, it creates the user interface, and it can execute JavaScript. Where we are at the moment. And here's kind of what I talked about. I hope your students don't create pages that generate 366 HTTP requests. It could be, so depending on if you have ad blocking on or some media blocking on, it might not be downloaded. Oh, you're just doing the Google search. If you can go to New York Times, NYT. Script creates a, the browser creates a set of elements and renders it on the page. We can manipulate those elements in the browser. We're not changing the web, what's on the web server, but we can manipulate what we're seeing in the browser right at the moment. And kids have fun with this. So again, if I use the inspect, it takes me in the elements pane right to that item. Some of them are a little trickier. And if I click into that, I can actually edit the text here. And all I've done is I'm just changing that object as currently displayed in the browser. So what I did was just change this headline to have my name in it. And again, all we're doing is changing what's in the browser at the moment. If I refresh the page, it's going to get the new page and render it. So students, as part of having them learn the tool, I asked them to go find a new story and replace a name. So a lot of times they find a sports story and they put their name in there, entertainment story. So if you just click inspect, it's going to get you to the elements tab, and then if you double click that item, it should become editable. Now let me warn you, a moment. Let me get your eyes up here for just a minute. It's okay. So, some of your enterprising students will realize that the online gradebook is a web page that displays their grades. And they could change the current display of it and take a picture of it and show it to their parents. So it's a fine time to talk about ethics and responsibility, and also the ability to and the need to question what is presented to us. They also learn how easy it is to make a fake page that looks like this, right? I could just copy all this HTML and create my own page that looks like the New York Times, or that looks like the Chase Bank login, right? And capture somebody's login. Now the address isn't gonna say Chase Bank, but if you're not a sophisticated user, you can easily be fooled. And the person who put that page up could be capturing the username and password you enter. If I was doing this, I would just present a screen that says, sorry, the system's down, please check back in 5 minutes. During that 5 minutes, I'm gonna log into their account on the actual site, empty their accounts, and then when they do log on again, they're gonna find they have no money. So, I was recently talking with another faculty member here who teaches an ethics course in the computer science department. And we talked about the need to start embedding discussions about ethics throughout our computer science education.
Right.
It can't be a thing that's stuck off on the side, right? Like it's an optional thing to learn more about. So it's be everywhere.
Can you go back to what you did? Because I can't.
Yes.
This is a great discussion, but.
It is. So if you right click and select inspect on any element, it opens the elements tab, and then you can double click on it, and then you can edit the text part of that element. You could, if you know enough about that, you could actually replace the image on a page. It's a useful activity for students to come to understand that a page is a collection of objects, and that the browser is an application that creates those objects based on the HTML.
Because ground zero is showing that the internet is created by that, like by us.
Right.
By
That's I'm fond of saying HTML is not just a more cumbersome way to make a Word document, right? If that's all it was used for, we'd just make Word documents or Google Docs. All right. So let's move on. All right. So, the language that the browser can process and execute, the programming language, is called JavaScript. Has no fundamental connection with the Java language. They use JavaScript as the name just for marketing purposes. Java was out and becoming popular, and I forget what the goofy name they originally gave it was, but somebody said, hey, let's call it JavaScript. That'll be much... Right. So, there's some syntax similarities, but down at the level at which the computer understands it, they're very different languages. And again, a few more minutes of intro until we do some more play. So, JavaScript is used in browsers and servers and Internet of Things devices. jQuery is a library that somebody created out of JavaScript. It is just JavaScript, but it's a set of functions that make it a lot easier for us as professionals and for our students to develop sophisticated stuff. We kind of abstract away one level of gory detail. So we're going to do a little work with the jQuery library. DOM is a phrase you'll see a lot if you do any work in this space. It stands for the Document Object Model. That's just the model of all the objects in the browser. So when we say DOM manipulation, that means just what we did, right? Change the content of an element, adding elements, removing elements. We can do all that with JavaScript and the jQuery library. We can hook up events so that when you click on this button, this thing happens. So that's handling events. And we can do something. We can make HTTP requests from the script itself. You made HTTP requests by typing in an address in the browser, but we can do that on the back end to do things like get data for our app, to get additional content, to send data. We can do all that without reloading the page, because it's all happening under the hood. We'll look at a little example of that. All right, a little intro and then a little playing. How many people in here have done any programming? Scratch, Java, JavaScript, anything? Okay. So jQuery, the way we make statements, execute commands in jQuery, first we type the dollar sign. We identify a selector. That's how we get our hands on one or more specific objects on the page. If you've worked with CSS, it's the exact same kind of selectors. We can identify elements by their tag. This first one would get us all the paragraph tags on the page, and then we can do things with them. The second one would give us everything with a class that has a class of menu item, and then we can do it. And the dot indicates that we're selecting one class. And then we can select on a specific ID of an item. All right, go ahead. Yeah, we'll see you next time. There's lots of other selectors. We don't want to get down into too many gory details. After we identify the elements we're working with, we indicate an action, and sometimes they take parameters. So we might say, okay, find this item, set its text to the value that I'm passing. Or it might be, and we'll do a couple of these, it might be find all the paragraphs dot hide to hide them off the page. We're going to play around with this just in the JavaScript console for a couple minutes, but you would actually write these in the JavaScripting blocks of your page to have them executed there. All right, so I think we've got more interaction here. So here now I'm saying navigate to UIC and get the dev tools open. The reason we're going to UIC is because I know the UIC site uses the jQuery library. So it's already been loaded in the browser for our page. So we can execute commands using it.
What?
There's another tab up here. We looked at Elements and Network. There's another one titled Console. That is the JavaScript console where we can read messages and execute code. So, all right. So like I talked about, let's take it step by step. So if I type in $ and then in quotes H2, it's not going to select all image elements. So I'm not sure why I put that in. Must have been different. You want to select all H2 elements. Let me show you quickly. So, if I have this open, I'm just typing in $. Here, let me zoom this up. So I'm just typing in H2. That's going to say, hey, go find all the H2 elements on the page. If you don't know HTML, H2 is header 2, the second level of headers. And if I just hit enter, it's returned this list of 18 different H2 elements on the page. And if I wanted to, I could expand this and dive into each one and get the details about each one. And at some point, as I'm mousing over them, I would actually be able to see them highlighted on the page. There we go. There it is. So, the first H2, the one at position 0 in the list, is this one over here. But again, all that command does is say, hey, I found a collection of all the H2 elements on the page. But now let's execute a command against that. So one of the commands we can do is to change any CSS property. So change all those H2s, change their color to red. And if you've got your copy of the slides, you can just copy and paste that, or you can type it in. And that's slide 20. And then after you've done that, try hiding them all by running that last command. Present that big. Can modify any CSS property of these elements. And everything we're talking about today, you could go 100 levels deeper. But that's not necessary to give our students a good experience in that problem solving, in that idea generation, in that collaboration, in that making sure it's user friendly, right? In that upfront work of defining. Yep.
It's
beautiful.
In my understanding, I haven't gotten to this JavaScript or jQuery yet. So HTML has all the elements. CSS styles it.
Styling and position.
Yeah. And then what does JavaScript and jQuery then put on top of it?
That's what gives us interactivity. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anytime something happens on the page, right, if images slide in a carousel or something happens when you click a button, that's all because somebody wrote some JavaScript to do those things.
How do I unhide?
How do you unhide? It's actually unhide. I think it's unhide.
I'm pretty sure it's unhide as well.
You can write your own library someday that has. Did it work or no?
No, it doesn't like unhide. It's a.
Oh, it's show. I'm sorry. It's show.
And then, so we open it with parentheses there.
So, if you had used the remove command instead of the hide, you would have actually been removing those objects from the document object
module.
Exactly.
So, is there like an undo? So, what else? So,
command Z.
All right.
That's kind of cool.
So all I'm doing here is just giving you some exposure to the syntax of jQuery. In a few minutes, we're going to get into a couple of details. So let me keep going. I'm going to skip some things at the moment. If I get your eyes back up here for a minute, I want to run through a couple things. So, right, our raw materials are the user interface elements. There's some frameworks to let us develop things that look better. We don't really start from scratch anymore. We use frameworks that people have developed. Data is some of the raw materials we use, and something called APIs, right? So Google Maps is an API that we can use. It's for application programming interface. We can use Google's Translate API to send text to it and have it come back in a different language. We can use their Cloud Vision API to send them a picture and get data about what's in that picture. So these are the raw materials we use to build our apps. Our tools are development environment and JavaScript and jQuery. All right. So building a user interface, we can go from a very basic level, just typing in regular tags, to using some framework that's been built out and developed a little more. To be more advanced, we can add our own functionality to elements. We can say, okay, well, when I click on an image, it's going to spin around, or it's going to double in size or something. And then even more advanced, we can build our own components, which would be one or more HTML elements with some functionality we define. At this stage of the game, when I'm working with students, we use somebody else's framework component library, because that's how they can start building sophisticated looking things pretty easily. And we're going to look at one of those frameworks and then do a couple of activities. All right. Again, if you have your slides, you can click to this site. If you don't, you can go to material.io. Material design is Google's name for their visual language. You know that Google applications look a certain way, and it's not an accident. Lots of people at Google have spent lots of time developing a visual language. Think of how many apps you use that don't really have detailed instructions on them. By this time, we've been using mobile apps. We kind of know what that large button in the lower right is going to do. We know what that little three-line menu icon is going to do. We have a guess of what's going to happen if there's, like, in Gmail, right, or any mail, right? There's a line that represents one mail object. And we know what's going to happen when we click that. We're going to navigate to the detail view. So we all understand the visual language about apps, and we want to make sure when we're building ours out that we don't confuse people. If everybody knows what those three lines mean and what should happen, don't make it do something different in your app. That's not user-friendly, as people talk about. And we're not going to go into detail, but I just want you to know, so they've defined all these components, and I'll just bring up a couple that you know. So you see a lot of apps now that represent things in tiles or cards, right, with some information about a product or a restaurant or something. So a card is a component that they've designed. These things called chips, you see these with these kind of rounded definitions. That thing that is in the corner is called a floating action button. It has a name. Lists, these kinds of lists in an app. Somebody at Google said, hey, this is how we're going to present this certain kind of information. And again, not don't need to know details at the moment, but this is how we make that kind of list. It's just HTML tags with certain classes on them. Here's the two line thing, and we're just copying and pasting what somebody else defined and then hacking it up to be our own. Again, all I want you to know for the moment is that these kinds of component libraries exist. We can use them to build nice looking stuff. And again, I'm gonna leave you with a template in a few minutes that we can hack up and you can share with your students to build their own apps. All right, just a couple more things. Anybody here ever visited the City of Chicago Data Portal as part of your class? What is the City of Chicago Data Portal?
Well, I use it to try to get train time information.
Okay.
Is it the same portal? I think it might be the same portal. It's a location where a lot of data is dumped that people can access and manipulate how they please.
Right, so we live in a world now where organizations make lots of data available, right? Lots of municipalities, lots of non-governmental organizations, even folks like Twitter and Facebook make lots of data available. And we can access that through our scripting language. We're actually gonna do that in a little detail in a minute, so let me skip ahead of that right now. All right. Putting it all together. All right, now I want you to navigate to this link. Change that to something more meaningful. Save their work. They can work on it at the library, at their friend's house, at a relative's house. what you're looking at is one that I already made, and what I want you to do is make your own copy of it. I'm hoping there's, is there a link up there? Yes, fork. So up at the top, you don't see it on my display, but in the main window up at the top, there's three buttons. It says share and
run.
Fork is a commonly used term in the software world. It means to make your own branch, a copy of something.
It's like a remix.
So, yes, it's exactly like a remix.
You're back in the browser?
I popped it out full screen. There's an open and new window.
Okay, that's the step I missed. Now what is
it? One other thing about the DevTools, there's a little icon that has like a phone and a tablet. If you click that, it shows you how your work is going to look on a phone or a tablet.
Yeah. I don't either.
It's even clickable. You don't need to worry about that. I actually don't want to take that road just yet.
Okay.
So when you pop out that, when you click on that, pop it out to a new tab.
Yep.
I get a thing that says run the REPL to see the output.
Yes.
So what do I have to do?
Back on the REPL, you need to click run. Basically, that's just going to do what it needs to do once on the REPL.
Where's the run? I'm sorry. Oh, I see it. I see it.
That's all right. We're covering a lot of stuff.
Okay. Now it works. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So you can leave that open, but back on the REPL, I just want to talk you through what's here. Let me get your eyes up front for just a minute so I can talk you through this. So we got the index page. This is the base page for the app. This is what you're going to when the REPL loads. And it's just the shell. It's got the HTML for this drawer, it's called, that opens, which would be our navigation. And it's got some other basic stuff that's part of it. The only thing your kids or you might change on it are where it says My Cool App, or in the drawer where it says Header Content Goes Here. That in the Material Components language, that's called a drawer. And that's created in here with this, this aside element, which is one of the newer elements of HTML. The only thing let me get you back up here one more time, and I will be very happy to answer questions offline, and I want to do a larger event on this to give us some more details. The way this is working is when you click on a link in the menu, goes out, right? We talked about the network stuff a minute ago. The content for each individual page is in its own folder there. And so what it does is it goes out and gets the relevant page. I don't have a page called About. That's why nothing's loading. So here's what we're going to do for the moment. In Replit, highlight this page content folder, click the new file icon, and we're going to make an about page. Title it _about.html.
Dave, I've got a question for you.
Yeah.
I've noticed that there is a standard of starting some of these pages with the underscore. What is that?
Basically, things that get included but are not base source files themselves. That's
okay.
One way to talk about it.
And can we also mention the other basic standard that all of the images are in one folder and the pages are in another?
Okay.
They're not just random. It's like a basic thing. Even if you're working in HTML.
So now I'm going to type in some content for the About page. It's not going to be very exciting. But now when I click the About page menu item.
And every time you make a change, you have to click Run, right?
I don't think so.
Okay.
So, now that I have an About file, when I click the About menu link, it goes and finds that file and loads it into my app. Notice that it doesn't refresh the whole page. I'm going and making a request, I'm getting that content, and I'm saying, put it in this part of the document. Replace the content that's there. So now I can click the Home page and go back to that. And now that gives me the home page again. Your students can add new pages to this. I've tried to make it more student friendly. All right, back here in the Replit, if you go to the index.js page, I created a variable here at the top, at the top of the file. You don't have to know a lot about programming. This has two elements that have information about the different pages I want in my app. I have the navigation display title, what should show up in that sidebar. I have the name of the file that it should go get. And then the icon part is broken a little bit. So let's add one of these to show you how your students would do it. So let's add another page that says EdCamp, all right? So here's the steps, right? This is a set of two elements. There's an opening and closing bracket. Just copy one of these, paste it inside the closing bracket, and make sure you put a comma after this. And let's change the display title to EdCamp, and we'll create a file called _ Well, here you'll just put EdCamp in lowercase, and then we'll create the file for that. So, couple step process. So I'm just gonna copy this one. I'm gonna put a comma, new line character, and I'm gonna create another one. The display title can be upper and lowercase. That's just the label on the screen. The file, I'm gonna keep all lowercase. I'm gonna call it EdCamp. And we cannot worry about the icon right now, but I'm gonna fix that at some point. So now, that shows us saved up here. Okay. Now if I go back and refresh the page, if it's not broken, now there's a link for EdCamp in the drawer. That's all I needed to add another link to the drawer. If I click it, there's no file yet. So let's add the file with our EdCamp content. So if I go back to the Replit, and I put these in a folder called page content, just make our lives easier. And so again, highlight page content, click the new file. I'm going to call it _edcamp.html. The only thing that's crucial is that it matches what I have in here, because that's the file it's going to be looking for when I click that menu button. And so now I can put some content in here. And your kids, right, maybe they're going to make a page that has pictures of things they like. Maybe it has contact information for their family members. Maybe it has their school schedule, right? Now if I go back, that should be saved. And if I refresh this, now the hello from EdCamp shows up. All right, we're going to go just a couple more minutes here. The next session doesn't start until 3:30, but we want to have a little break. Needs a hand getting that part working, getting their EdCamp menu item and page loaded. Well, and so one of the things, right, like, and one of the whole ideas around CS education now is like, if we want to give our kids good experiences, the solution isn't going to be finding people who know a lot about computer science and putting them in front of kids. It's going to be about finding people who know how to teach and care about giving their kids opportunities and give them materials. This session isn't designed to give you skills to put in front of your kids.
So
that's good. Really, what I want to do is, for some people, I just want people to know what's possible out there on the web. And one of my goals is to get a unit that anybody can use to walk their kids through some of this. And it would basically be this, but built out a lot more clearly. But you know how it is. Your kids are going to pick it up.
Really a
easily.
Lot faster than I
would. All right.
So take
that's all right. One more step. Because it's not a mobile app yet, right? Let's get it on the phones. So could type this address into your phone if you want for yours, whatever yours is. But usually I find the easiest way is to just email the link to myself and then open up the link on my phone. So however you do it, I want you to open up the address for your app, your Replit, get it to your phone. So again, I'm just going to email it to myself. But when you did the fork, you should have created a different. You're still working in mine. Did you create an account on Replit?
Hey Dave.
Yes.
A really cool tool for doing something like this
is, have you ever heard of Yell Key?
No.
Yell Key is a URL shortener.
Oh,
and then it makes, like, with it, with normal words, which are easier to...
Right, right. All right, let me just get your eyes and ears again for just a minute. So, let me get your eyes back here for our last piece. All right, so one of the things that's happened with the web is that the browser manufacturers and the device manufacturers have enabled a feature. So if you have files, one's called the Web App Manifest, and another is called a Service Worker, if those exist in your package of pages, it will install it as an app on your phone. And I've included those in the replet that you copied so that they're there for you and your kids. So when I click this link, well, because I've already installed it, it's going to say, do I want to open it with my cool app, because it's already there. But you should get, if you're an Android app, or if you're a fairly recent iOS Safari user, you should be prompted to install it.
And if we're not,
if you have your own, if you created your own replet, you might need to go and make it public. You may need to share the replet. Sorry about that.
I think they're public by default.
Yeah, you need to share.
Is it valid replet? Tremendous amount of evolution in the web technologies and the browser technologies in the last 3 years. And we can do all sorts of things with the web that we once couldn't do. What this page shows is what the browser and device I'm currently on can do. But we can do all sorts of things that we couldn't do before, right? We can activate the device features. I can write JavaScript to activate the camera, capture a picture, send it to Google's Vision API, get back data about what's in that image, and present it on the screen in my app, all using the web technologies in JavaScript. I can work with device features like the accelerometer, the location, right? The sensors. We can store data on the device so that your apps can work offline, right?
That's all an Android app is. It downloads the app file on your phone, and it's there, and it just gets the data it needs as it's running. We do the same thing now with the web apps. We download the HTML and CSS, we store it on the phone, and for any data we need, we just make one of those calls under the hood. My goal today, as we were talking in the back, is not for you to walk out of here saying, I know exactly how to do this. My goal is just to give you a sense of some of the things that are possible. I'm going to be putting together more materials to help teachers bring more of this to their class, along with some more examples of different kinds of things. I applied for a Google for Education grant to do a PD week about this topic. They didn't approve it this year, but at some point I'll be putting something out on the CSTA mailing list asking, seeing what level of interest there is in learning more about this. Because I think it's a great entry for our kids. Our kids can participate as creators of sophisticated technology. And it's so easy now, right? You can build an app to share with five friends, right? It doesn't take a major company to build an app, right? You can build an app just to share information with five friends. There's many more places to go, right? We can build multiplayer games using the web technologies. So that there would be communication going on under the hood while you're playing the game. So look, I know this is a lot of material. I'll be posting several links on the shared doc to some of the tools, some of the learning resources. I can talk about this stuff all day. So if you have questions, if you'd like, maybe one thing that'll get me off my butt and really creating lessons is for people to say, hey, I'd like a lesson on, doing this for my third grade. Or doing this for my ninth graders. And maybe that will inspire me to work with others to build some of this. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.